I am Adam.
Hi, I'm Joe.
Joe.
I would like to thank you for choosing.
Please have your headset ready for...
Adam and Joe in the studio, coming through loud and clear. Hello, yes, this is XFM.
Hello, this is Adam and Joe on XFM. That was Feeder with Feeling a Moment. We're here with you for the next 2 hours. Say hello, Adam.
Hi, how you doing? And before Feeder, you heard Block Party, of course, with Banquet. Now, what have we got coming up on the show today, Joe? What can we tease?
All sorts of stuff.
All stuff.
Yeah, stuff. We've got a competition in which you can win Bubba Hotep. That might be Ditties in the Dock, actually, towards the end of the 2 hours. And we're going to have a celebrity regression, where you could win a special edition of Apollo 13, the film about the men that go into space in the spaceship.
Directed by the man from Happy Days.
Yeah. So there we go. What more motivation could you possibly need for listening? As well as terrific music from the likes of Queens of the Stone Age, the Libertines, the Ordinary Boys, the Future Heads, Weezer, and that's just the first hour.
Wow.
Extraordinary.
That's unbelievable.
Plus, we're going to be talking about provocative pop culture-related subjects. And if you want to join in, you can text us on 83XFM or email us, adamandjoe@xfm.co.uk.
Have you got some provocative stuff up your sleeves?
I have. Today, well, yesterday, I went to see the Amityville Horror remake.
Oh, yeah, we talked about that a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah,
and I was speculating that it was going to be a pointless waste of time.
Well, how sort of on spot on you were.
Okay, well, we'll find out more.
Yeah. I tell you what I've done.
What have you done?
I've drawn up a list of ten...
Oh, thank God, I thought you'd kill someone.
Yeah, no. Well, might have done that as well. I've also drawn up a list of 10 things that are no longer scary.
Good one.
Okay, 10 things that should just be... They should stop doing in horror films.
Right, little scenes.
Because they're not scary anymore.
Little techniques.
I'd like to issue this to all filmmakers.
Very good.
A round robin email.
Round Robin. I love Round Robin.
I'm full of all the phrases today.
Yeah.
But that's coming up in a bit.
Very exciting. Right now, let's just play some music, yeah, just to keep the energy up. Mm. Here's Queens of the Stone Age. Knockers.
Is it enough just to go,
Yeah, I think that sort of proves that it is.
It is enough.
It's more than enough. Well done, Queens of the Stone Age.
They are from the Stone Age, I suppose. They're sort of Stone Age noises.
It's more kind of medieval. They're Queens of the Medieval Age, I would say.
Okay.
But very good. That's called Little Sister. I haven't watched that much TV and stuff this week.
You know, this very, you've let us all down.
Well, I feel as if I haven't done my work, my homework, you know? I've just been sort of having a kind of different life. And doing other things. I went on the London Eye again. I'm pretty much a regular on the London Eye. That was good fun. But the last thing I watched that made an impression on me, apart from Dead Man's Shoes, which I got on DVD, which was brilliant, I strongly recommend you look at that if you haven't seen it. Paddy Considine. Oh, I'm quite attracted to Paddy Considine, I think, now. Anyway, the last thing I saw on TV that made an impression was the 50 Greatest Sketches on Channel 4.
Yeah, we've been away for a week. We weren't here last weekend. And I think the 50 Greatest Sketches was possibly just after we were on last.
Yeah, a couple of weeks
ago.
On
Channel 4, yeah.
On a Sunday, maybe. They've got this new presenter guy. Was Jimmy Carr presenting that one?
I don't know. I didn't see it.
I was going to make a lame joke about Jimmy Carr. I'm not sure that he was presenting it, actually. But, you know, it was just the usual kind of roundup of random list type business from Channel 4. Basically, three or four. I'd love to know exactly how it worked. Maybe if someone from Channel 4 could phone up and let us know what the process was. Because it's all hung around a poll.
Is.
Yeah, what is it?
There's a preordained list of sketches on the website. And so you choose, I think, out of an already sort of selected gathering of sketches.
Yeah.
So you can't just chuck anything in.
Mm-hmm.
I think you're choosing from, you're putting a 50 that Channel 4 have suggested in order. I think that's correct.
Yeah, that's more or less how it would work. Mm. Because they've got to figure out what they can show clear ability-wise, and what they want to show to prop up their notion of what constitutes great comedy.
Are you talking about Beau Selector?
I don't mind Beau Selector. There was a couple of people.
What are you talking about then? What's made you angry?
It makes me a little, as much as I like Little Britain, to have, Lou and Andy in the swimming pool, the number one greatest sketch of all time.
Well, that's the same as Robbie Williams being voted the number one songwriter of all time, isn't it? It's just whoever's big at the time always goes to number one.
It's ludicrous.
That's all the kids know.
I know, and
ludicrous.
I know.
Ludicrous.
It's ludicrous.
Is he at number one?
He's at number one. He's amazing.
Luda.
He's a new rapper. But no, you know, it's something I've banged on about so many times, and it's a bit, I'm sounding like an old man about it, but it just, it's like a fresh slap in the face every time you see one of those shows, you know what I mean? No Alexei Sayle in there.
No Adam and Joe.
No Adam and Joe. Did we ever do a sketch? We never did sketches.
We transcended the sketch format. We were beyond sketches.
We didn't have catchphrases or sketches or anything funny. We got rid of all that kind of stuff. But, you know, it just made me angry. And it reminded me again of my brilliant idea for a new kind of sketch show.
Mm.
So you've got Goodness Gracious Me, which you could say was for the Asian community, Smack the Pony for ladies, the sketch show for special needs viewers, and for the gay community, you could have Ooh Ducky, which would be a new kind of sketch show with all sketches about being gay.
Right.
What do you reckon? Are you excited?
That's exciting.
Now, here's a sample sketch. Middle-aged gay couple, they're watching TV, their son comes in and says, "Hi, Dad, I've got something to tell you." No, hi, Dad, you get a laugh there, because he says, hi to two, anyway.
Okay,
I've got something to tell you. "What is it, son?" says one of the dads. I'm straight, says the son. "You're what?" And they're furious, because they're gay. He's
quick, play a record. Play
coming
record,
out
quickly, play a record.
Because he's
play a record.
But do you understand the brilliance of Ooh Ducky?
Yeah.
Oh no.
Turn us up. Turn the record up. Turn us down.
Okay.
Is he saying makes me potty there?
Makes him potty.
Oh, I thought it was terrifies me. It makes me potty.
That's David Bowie with Modern Love. When was that from? 1984,
5 or something like that?
Really?
Yeah.
So coming up in a second, celebrity regression. I'm going to regress Adam into the mind and films of a film star. You have to guess what film and who the star is. You could win a copy of the Apollo 13 Special Edition. Two discs.
Wow.
Yeah.
Imagine.
And Baba Hotep, or Baba Hotep, depending on what you want.
Depending on what you want. It's a really easy one this week, so stand by your phones. I'll give out the number now. Yeah, what the hell? 0871-222-1049. That's the number to call, not only for competition time, but for anything, just for a chat. It's,
What are you saying?
I don't know. I don't know what I'm saying. Adam and Joe here on XFM. XFM. God, just caught me. Almost caught me out there. I was almost a bit like, nothing's going to stop us now.
Nothing's going to stop us now. Who invented that style of singing?
He did.
Did he? It's not Chris Martin. It's slightly Chris Martin, isn't it?
Oh, I suppose.
It's going like that.
It's as if someone's pinching his little bum while he's singing.
Or just he's really anxious about the world and the environment, and he can't quite sing. It's sort of, I'm almost about to burst into tears, isn't it?
Look.
That's the whole style of early noughties singing.
Uh-huh.
Don't pinch my bum! I think pinching the bum is just a bit...
Don't pinch my bum!
That would be less interesting if that was all it was.
Sometimes it's as simple as that.
Is it?
Yeah. It's all it comes down to, a little technique like that.
Okay, 0871-222-1049. I'm about to put Adam under. If you can guess what film star he's being regressed into and what the films are, you could win either a copy of Baba Hotep or Apollo 13. Are you ready, Adam?
I am ready.
Ring the bell.
Okay.
This is Celebrity Regression. If you'd like to be regressed along at home, as long as you're not operating a heavy vehicle or in charge of young children, then do feel free. Take deep breaths, in through the nose, out through the mouth, expand the stomach, and drift, clear your mind, etc., you know the sort of thing. Drift back, you're 5, you're 4, you're 3, you're 2, you're 1, you're a tiny little fetus, you're a little spermatozoa, and now you're a glint in the milkman's eyes.
Glinty.
That's the milkman's name, Glinty.
Giving.
And now you are in the mind and the films of a movie star.
Moby.
Open your eyes, Adam, and tell us what you see.
Oh. I'm in an office. Oh, it's so boring. It looks like a hospital room or something boring. This place is full of stiffs, and I mean literally. Take the guy I've got to work with. He's boring my entire ass off. But that always happens to me because my ass is crazy. Why else would I listen to a live version of Jumpin' Jack Flash by the Rolling Stones over and over again on my Walkman? That's right, because I'm a crazy ass. And to prove it, I'm gonna do something crazy to this boring place, man. I'm gonna make a crazy sex party, and it's gonna be full of nice prostitutes. Not the nasty drug-addicted ones, but nice ones who just want to make some money and have some fun. And thanks to me and my crazy ass and my Walkman, they can jumping jack flashes. Yes, yes, yes. Look out,
okay.
My crazy ass.
Just breathe. Just
what
breathe.
I'm
now
going
to... Can you finish?
Yeah.
I'm now going to take Adam into the mind and movie... well, you know, the same movie star, different movie. Wake up, tell us what you see.
I'm in bed. I've got a headache. Oh, there's someone in bed with me. Oh, my crazy ass. Oh, no, wait, she's dead. From a drug overdose. Oh, no. Also, my bad real estate dealings have left me in terrible debt. My sleazy life is catching up with me. I'd better hide, but where can I be guaranteed anonymity? I've got it! A rehab center. But now, I'm being forced by my tough but kindly counselor to look at my problems. Ooh, look at my problems. My ass isn't crazy anymore. In fact, my ass is delivering the performance of a lifetime. Drugs are bad. Do you understand me? I'm crying. I want an Oscar, please. No. Dustin Hoffman's taking the Oscar. I can't believe it. That's typical just for pretending to be simple. They want my ass to be crazy again. But I want a serious ass. I've got a serious ass. Look at my serious ass.
0871-222-1049. Let's regress Adam into the third and final film. Adam, open your eyes. Tell us what you can see.
Excuse me. I'm cold. Oh, I'm very cold. I'm cold on two levels. Level one, I'm cold as a father. For example, I'm always traveling around with my bad music band featuring Mark Addy from the Full Monty, who was kidnapped from England and forced to make bad films in America for the rest of his life. The problem is, I spend too much time playing bad blues and I neglect the most important thing in my life. My crazy ass. No, no, my son. My son. And because of that reason, I'm now literally cold. And also, I have a carrot in my face and a disturbingly evil expression, which is not intentional. Some people say this is the worst film ever made, but I'll kill them. There's something for everyone in this movie. Fun snow action for kids, lessons on being a good father for the grown-ups, and my crazy ass for the brain dead. Catch my ass before it melts.
Okay,
that's a
wow.
Clue. That's a clue.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Wow, this is, previously you sort of witnessed the movies. Now you're aware that you're in movies.
What?
The regression may be finally working. 0871-222-1049. If you know what film star and what films Adam was being regressed into, you could win a wicked DVD.
Baba Hotep.
Can't Stand Me Now by The Libertines, the first single to be taken from London, the London Quartet's eponymous second album out on August the 30th. I'm reading that. You join us midway through Celebrity Regression. Adam has been regressed into the mind and movies of a famous film star. Roland is on the line. He thinks he knows the film star and the movies. Hello, Roland.
Hi.
How are things going?
Not bad.
Are you talking on a homemade phone?
No, I'm on the mobile. I'm actually in a very big room.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, what's your guess at the well, hang on a second, Roland.
Okay.
I'm going to get you to say, well, how are we going to do this? I've forgotten how we do this. I can't ask Adam because he's been regressed.
On three films, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Tell me the three films, first of all, Roland. What do you think they are?
Sister X.
Yeah.
Jumping Jack Flash.
Yeah.
And Ghost.
Okay, and I want you to say the name of the star, and if you're correct, Adam will come out of his regressed state. Say the name of the star.
Whoopi Goldberg.
Whoopi.
Roland, you're wrong. He's still in his regressed state. Well, how did you get Whoopi?
Pardon me?
How did you arrive at Whoopi?
Well, she went Jumping Jack Flash. She went like a prostitute. She was a prostitute in Sister Act, no, wasn't she?
Whoopi has never been a prostitute. Has she in Sister Act?
She hanging out with other prostitutes in Sister Act. And she's like undercover nun or something.
I've tried never to see Sister Act and undercover nun. Oh, and what, yeah, well, it's wrong, Roland. I know where you got that from. Jumping Jack Flash makes sense, doesn't it? But, maybe she was a prosy at the beginning of Sister Act, I don't know. But I'm sorry, Roland, you're wrong. We cannot reward you with Baba Hotep, but thank you very much for calling. Let's go to James. Hello, James.
Hi there.
Hey, James, do you think you might have got it right?
I think I have, yeah.
Okay, tell us the films first.
Right, I know the first film is Night Shift.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, second film?
The second film I don't know.
What? Okay, but move on to the third film.
The third is Jack Frost.
Wow. And what's the name of the star? Again, if you get it right, Adam will wake up. If you get it wrong, he'll remain under.
Michael Keaton.
That's extraordinary. Oh, wow. I'm awake.
Now, I could talk for half an hour about Jack Frost alone.
Yeah, of course.
How come you've seen Jack Frost, James?
I haven't actually seen it.
Yeah, well, you know, obviously know about it.
I'm very aware of it, yeah.
Everyone knows about the film.
Everyone's picked it up and looked at it, but we've not had the balls to actually rent it.
Well, who would, though, with
I
evil...
did. Did you really?
Yeah, I've seen Jack Frost.
With the evil snowman on the front.
Yeah. That's amazing.
It's an extraordinary film.
Oh, well, the middle one... is this James we're talking to?
Yeah.
That's right, yeah.
James, the middle, of course you got Night Shift directed by Ron Howard. There's a little tie-in there because we're giving away Ron Howard's extraordinary Apollo 13 later on. But that starred Michael Keaton as well as he, the Fonz, Henry Winkler. There's a couple of guys who set up a kind of brothel in a morgue.
Good film, Night Shift.
It's not bad. Mm. The second one was Clean and Sober.
Boring film.
That was a boring film. That was Michael Keaton's bid for Oscar glory, but he was... He's not even nominated that year, and Hoffman walked off with all the statues for Rain Man.
Do you care about any of this, James?
Oh, yeah, it's fascinating.
Yeah, okay. There you go.
Keep going, Ad. I was just checking.
Well, it's just a little bit of background info on some of the films in the competition. Jack Frost was the last one.
Mm, that's all there is to say about
that's
Jack
all there
Frost.
Is to say. It's for people who don't know, Keaton plays a father who's been neglecting his fatherly duties, who dies in a car crash, and is reincarnated as a snowman, who then is a much better father to his son until he begins to melt. And it's much weirder than it sounds, if that's possible.
So, James, Bubba Hotep or Apollo 13?
Oh, I'd really like Bubba Hotep, please.
You got it. It's coming your way.
Cheers.
We're glad, actually, because we were worried about what we were going to do with that copy of Bubba Hotep. But, James, it's winging its way to you, and very much hope you enjoy it. Thanks very much for calling in. Here's a free play right now. This is by Silver Jews. And
what?
It's called People.
Silver what?
Silver Jews. They're Jews, and they're silver. You know, they're members of the Jewish community.
Okay, Silver Jews.
Silver Jews.
Fine.
There you go, that's called People by Silver Jews. This is Adam and Joe on XFM. We're going to have a kind of text competition very soon, aren't we, Joe?
Yes, we are. Yes, we are, yes.
We're going to be introducing that shortly. Also, you just dropped a bomb on me. I completely forgot that you went to the Make Me a Supermodel sort of finale party.
That's correct. Regular listeners to the show will remember that I made a big fuss about it, so inevitably I got invited, and of course I went and had a fabulous time.
Wow, can't wait to hear about
the end
all
of
that.
The anecdote. That's it.
No, no.
That's the anecdote.
I'm going to squeeze more than that out of that anecdote, so join us again shortly. XFM. My Sharona. That's good, though. Who was it? I've completely forgotten. I think it's The Future Heads, of course. The Future Heads. There's a lot of bands that sound quite similar in their approach to the audio sound, including the Kaiser Chiefs, and, of course, before that with the Ordinary Boys. Quite similar. Not saying there's anything wrong with that. It's my favourite kind of music, so in a way, it makes me ecstatic. Joe, help me out here. I'm just babbling.
Yeah. No, it's good babbling. I was enjoying it.
Okay.
This is Adam and Joe on XFM. We're here with you for another hour and 5 minutes. Ditty's in the dock coming up at the end of the show, and we're going to do a text competition to win some rock and roll tickets to a rock and roll gig.
Oh, I love
it. Is it the Red Hot Chili Peppers?
The Manic Street
Preachers.
Behemoths.
Yeah, so here we go. I saw Amityville Horror yesterday.
Wow.
The remake of the classic, well, it's not really classic, the remake of the average 70s movie that's now an average noughties movie. And it's pretty average, but one of the things that was the most annoying about it was the fact that, you know, I see a lot of horror films, Ring 2, Grudge, Ring 1, all that shenanigans.
That's three. I've seen three horror films.
Well, I've seen a lot. Godsend I saw as well.
You don't have to say all that.
I see them all. And they're doing the same things in all of them. So I thought I'd just write a list of 10 things that... If there are any horror filmmakers listening, I'm not sure, there probably aren't. Douglas might be listening, our storyboard artist friend. He's got contacts in Hollywood.
Maybe, you know, Edgar Wright's listening.
Maybe Edgar's in Los Angeles. Oh. Maybe Garth's listening. Garth Jennings, director of Hitchhikers, he might be listening. Ah, basically, I'm wasting my breath. But here we go. The 10 things that I think are no longer scary and should be banned in horror films. If we were prepared, we'd have a sort of scary backing track for this.
But we
don't really. Okay, and number one. I don't think you should.
Okay.
Number one. Ghoulish women with long black hair emerging from unlikely places. That's an obvious one, isn't it?
That's J-horror, isn't
it? Yeah. But any woman with a pale face and very long black hair, it's just not scary anymore.
It's, is it called Kabuki?
No.
The tradition of movies that came from, the sort of,
No.
Yeah, but that's where it came from. I read an article with the guy who directed The Ring.
Right.
He said that all
well,
that...
Kabuki's not a film tradition, is it?
It's theatre.
Yeah.
And it, he said that's where the images come from, though. That
possibly, yeah. Well, I just think it should be stopped.
Okay.
Could you agree?
I know, I'm just giving it some historical context.
That's very good. I'm confused and frightened by your knowledge. At number two, any ghost on the ceiling, anti-gravity ghosts.
Yeah.
Like, any, you look up and you see hands and knees on the ceiling going...
Yeah.
It's not scary.
First time you saw that, can you remember?
The Fury.
Yeah, the Fury.
The geezer floating in
that
the
was
air
a great
in the Fury.
Moment.
Okay, but it's over now. The Fury was in the 70s, wasn't it? Early 80s.
It was
maybe.
A long time ago.
Yeah. Number three, anything coming out of the bath. While you're in the bath, hands coming out of the bath. Don't you think?
Yeah,
not scary.
Yeah.
Anything pulling you under the bath? It was good in Nightmare on Elm Street.
Nightmare on Elm Street, yeah.
When the hand with the knives came out. I think it was number two, was it? Or number one? I can't remember. Nearly slashed up her bits. That was good. But,
revolting image.
Well, it's from, not mine, it's
move
from
on,
the film.
Move on.
Number four, wide-eyed pale children with invisible friends.
Yeah.
Any child with an invisible friend, no, you know, it's done.
Yeah,
it's
no,
been done about six times in the last year.
Countless.
No more of those, please. By the way, all these things pretty much are in the Amityville remake. At number six, at number five, wide-eyed pale children who draw inappropriately horrifying pictures.
Mm.
You know, little Sammy sitting on his bed. Oh, what are you drawing, Sammy? A picture. And it's a disgusting picture of a man being decapitated and a demon. You know? There you go.
Lila, good.
Lila
is so exhausted. She's just run out there. She can barely breathe now. She's about to have a coronary.
Wouldn't you agree with that one, Adam, though?
Yeah, I would.
Yeah. Number six.
Yeah,
I'm going to start to speed up through these.
Okay.
Any and all shocking words scrawled on a wall in blood.
Yeah.
You know, you come into a room. In Amityville Horror, the remake, it's catch them and kill them. Spelt with a catch with a K. As if being bad at spelling is going to make him an even more horrifying killer.
Do you think that kind of thing predated the Manson murders?
No, I think it started with the Manson murders. That's what pretty much inspired it. But it shouldn't be carrying on, you know, 30 years later.
No, they even had it in, what was that film, was it Jagged Edge they had it in?
Yeah, it's in Hide and Seek, it's in Amityville Horror.
They
everyone.
Do it with fridge magnet letters.
The Adam and Joe way in Amityville Horror, so, you know, that's a bit of a progression. Okay, at number seven, any monster appearing in the bathroom mirror... Who then disappears when they turn around.
Right.
That's over. Surely that's over. I mean, as soon as anyone looks in a bathroom mirror in a horror film, you know there's going to be some demon popping up behind them.
Yeah, no.
Moratorium on that one.
Definitely.
At number eight, ghosts or monsters or possessed people with their heads wibbly-wobbling at high speed.
Oh, yeah. They didn't really have that in the Amityville Horror.
Yep, especially with bondage. They'll have someone, like, strapped into a weird torture device with a strap across their forehead. Oh, and then they'll film it at normal speed, right? The person wiggling their head. Then they speed it up and put an effect. That's just
Did they really
funny.
Put the wobbly effect on?
Yeah, they always put the wobbly effect on. It's just funny. It's not scary.
Well, yeah, again, first time I saw that was Jacob's Ladder.
Yeah, it was good at Jacob's Ladder.
It was brilliant.
Yeah.
Very impressive. Never seen it there. But yeah, they you know, that's the kind of thing that's going to pop up in a pot noodle advert next.
Stop it. I tell you what it'll pop up in is a road safety advert. Because that's where these devices end up, in road safety adverts. Then they finish. And number nine, a spectral figure darting through the picture very quickly, accompanied by a sudden loud noise.
Oh, yeah.
What was that? In the background, in the foreground, could be glimpsed while you're going up in a lift.
Mm-hmm.
That's how they do it in The Grudge. That's over.
Again, first time you saw that? Exorcist 3 was a good one.
That was brilliant. The guy darting through the corridor with the big scissors.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was the only good bit in that film.
Yeah, done. That's done. That's over. Moratorium on that one. And finally, at number 10, sudden loud noises generally. They're not frightening. I mean, shocks. Bang shocks. Nah, it's not one.
Sorry.
They're not frightening. They're just annoying and unpleasant and dangerous for people with heart conditions.
Yeah.
That sort of thing.
It's cinema's laziest device, isn't it?
So if you can contribute to that list, what do you think is the most overused thing in modern horror films? What should just be stopped? Text us, 83XFM, and we'll reward the best suggestion with tickets for the Manic Street Preachers at the Hammersmith Apollo on Tuesday the 19th of April. The most tired, cliched thing in horror films you've seen. Text us, 83XFM.
We'll be back very shortly. XFM. Yeah, Smile Like You Mean It by The Killers, and before that you heard Feel Good Incorporated by the Gorillaz. If you're a fan of new music, then XFM obviously is the best place for you. Joe, I'm mainly talking to you
yeah.
here.
Oh, thanks. Cool.
And I know that you're very excited about the new single from the White Stripes.
White Stripes.
Well, you can hear that on XFM next week when Sean Keaveney plays it. Oh. He's on 10 a.m. Monday morning playing the latest offering from Detroit's Finest. On Tuesday, Joe Cornish, you can hear Christian O'Connell debuting the new single from The Coldplay.
Wow.
Now, I don't know if you know this, but they're going to be really big. One of them's going out with a famous Hollywood star.
Coldplay.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah, he's going out with Kirstie Alley, I think. Mm. And you can hear that on Christian O'Connell's show on Tuesday after 8 a.m. at some point. And finally, if you're a Foo Fighters fan, which I certainly am, on Wednesday lunchtime, Ian Baker's going to be ready to play the new single from them, the Foo Fighters. So there you go. That's exciting, isn't it?
Brilliant stuff. We've been counting down our top 10 of things that are no longer frightening in horror. We finished counting it down. We were asking you for your suggestions. We've had some very good ones come in. Well done. Okay, here's some good ones. I mean, they're all fairly obvious so far. Pets growling at something and backing away.
That's good. Yeah, because the pets know.
What is it, Sniffy?
The animals can sense the evil.
Animals can sense the evil. I don't think my cat can sense evil, though.
Does your cat go towards evil?
Well, when I'm ever feeling spooked in the house, I always look to the cat first. And if the cat's curled up and happy, I think, fine, no poltergeists. But, what I'm saying is the cat's never been skittish, so maybe my house isn't haunted.
Right.
Horrific flashbacks accompanied by whispering, farty noises and smudgy images, says James. Now, that's a good one, I think. Flashbacks, you know, with sound effects on them and a bang on every single cut.
Oh, yeah, because they're kind of feeling some terrible event that happened in that
in
space.
In the past, yeah, some ancient historical killing. That, I don't want to give anything away. Oh, that's scary. Well, that's what, it's just a lawnmower. Isn't it?
I think it is just
a
lawnmower.
It's garden work. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, also, suggested by John from Bognor and by Fred, baddies who come back to life, and then who are shot suddenly by the hero's accomplice who's standing behind them. That's a convention of action movies and thrillers, really, and horror films. Mm. Another good one is cats jumping out of cupboards. Very prominent in The Grudge. A cat in a cupboard.
Yeah,
and says Will. And Will also asks the question, what are the cats doing in the cupboards in the first place?
Good point, Will.
I don't pop my cat in the cupboard. Maybe I should.
No, don't, because you'll freak yourself out, man, when it pops out.
That's true. I'll pop the cat's annoying me. Meow. I want food, that sort of stuff. Pop it in the cupboard. Forget about it.
Forget about it.
Open the cupboard. Oh, the cat! Oh, it's not a very scary scenario, is it?
That must have come from Alien. Was there cats jumping out before Alien?
It's mainly The Grudge. There's a very naughty cat in The Grudge who makes scary noises and then turns out just to be a cat.
Oh, yeah.
And the other one we had was just generally exploring scary things, which is, again, a bit of a cliche, isn't it? But everyone always does that.
Exploring scary
things? Well, you're in a clearly scary situation and you hear a noise, you go and investigate it.
Come on, if you stop people doing that, there's not going to be any horror films left.
I know, that's true. And someone was also asking, what are the things that are scary? What's the upside to this? And that's a good question.
Yeah, that's a good question.
I've got a couple of suggestions.
Ooh.
Things in bed.
Oh.
That's not a territory that's been covered a lot by horror films. It's done very well in The Grudge. She's in the bed. Suddenly there's an old crone between her legs.
Scrabbling around under the sheets.
You lift up the duvet to have a bit of a waft.
Yeah.
And then what is there but an old crone under there, fiddling around where she doesn't belong.
Double whammy,
isn't it?
Stinky fart smell and crone.
The other thing that you thought is still genuinely frightening, Adam, was violent, threatening, psychopathic people.
Yeah, well, atmosphere of impending
especially
violence.
Especially in Dead Man's Shoes.
Yeah, there's a
Paddy Considine. Someone who's actually nice, but also a nutter.
Exactly, you're never quite sure what's going to happen.
Yeah. I find knives very frightening.
Yeah.
Any sort of street crime or knife-related stuff,
there's
I find
frightening.
There's
a good bit in Psycho 2, isn't there, where he's just bashing around with a knife and someone's getting stabbed in the hands. Do you remember that?
I don't remember that. I remember the spade action in Psycho 2.
Oh, dear.
Anyway, we've yet to decide who to award the tickets to the Manic Street Preachers, so if you can think of a better scary thing that's no longer scary, text us, 83XFM, and you could win those tickets.
Yeah, we'll wrap that one up in the next link, I think. And I still want to hear about the Make Me a Supermodel party. Mm. But first, music. That's tune-packed. The magic numbers there with Forever Lost. This is Adam and Joe on XFM.
Now, we're going to put to bed our things that aren't scary anymore competition. Thank you very much to everybody who's texted in. We've had some fantastic suggestions, including a very good one, I think, is brass door handle movement.
Right.
Just a close-up of a door handle turning.
Yeah, turning, sure.
That's from Wellesley in Maidstone. He's right, they are always brass as well. Mm. In the Amityville Horror, they try and amp it up a bit by putting a crucifix on the door handle. Don't know a lot of people who are so religious they have crucifixes embossed onto their door handle, but of course, when it turns spookily, the crucifix is inverted! Which is something that only very, very evil people do, invert crucifixes.
That's right. That's yeah. why you would not have a crucifix on your door handle.
No, because every time anyone came in, you'd be...
you'd be naughty.
Tipping your head to Satan.
That's the kind of thing that Marilyn Manson probably does.
That hasn't been thought through properly by Andrew Douglas, the director of the Amityville Horror, who is in fact a British man.
Yeah.
And who one of our listeners' dad has worked with, according to another text.
We want Douglas on the phone now.
Andrew Douglas, to explain why would a Christian family have crucifixes on their door handles?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, they'd have them on there because they like Jesus and all, but what are they going to do about the inversion problem?
Yeah. That's a good point. Does that almost deserve the tickets?
Maybe it does.
Because I think it's between Wellesley and Maidstone for the brass door handle inversion and Cats Jumping Out of Cupboards from Will.
I'd go for the brass door handle. That's a more interesting observation.
Yeah, but I added the Amityville thing. Maybe I'll go with Wellesley.
Go with Wellesley.
I won't. Wellesley, you can win the tickets. Wellesley and Maidstone, congratulations.
Hey!
You've won those tickets to the Manic Street Preachers. Someone else suggesting that Frank in Blue Velvet is in fact one of the scariest characters in the film ever. And I think that's true. I think David Lynch is one of the... he's not really officially a horror director, is he?
No.
He's more of a... but his films are scarier than any horror films.
Yeah, well, definitely Blue Velvet's got that sort of impending violence from
Nutty
Person.
What's the one where the man... that really scary man turns up at the party with the phone and he gets the guy to speak to him.
Lost Highway.
That's Lost Highway. That's terrifying.
That is frightening. And the first time I saw Dune as well, the big fat floaty guy who rips out people's...
That's scary!
Come on, he goes over to a guy, he's got a plug in his heart and he tears it out and then sucks all the blood out. That is frightening.
Okay, that's a bit frightening.
Gosh.
Well done, there we go. Well done, Wellesley.
Nice one, Wellesley.
Wellesley!
So congratulations on that. Now, what was I going to say? Oh, yeah, very shortly, we're going to be finding out about Joe's time. And I'm really excited about this.
You're going to be so disappointed.
You're playing it down, but
I can't
possibly be disappointed. I just want to hear all about it. And if you, like me, want to hear all about it, stick with us. Adam and Joe on XFM. XFM.
Oh, it's just gone very cold in the studio. Maybe evil is here.
Well, that was Bernard Butler recombined with Brett Anderson, so they may have formed evil.
Oh, suddenly there's a very spooky...
I don't think so. It felt like magic to me, Joe.
Really? Musical magic?
Musical magic from the Refugees. No, the Tears, I'm sorry, and a song called Refugees. It's very cold outside, though. It seemed to be as if the summer was on. I know you get very upset and frustrated when I talk about the weather, but... It's
cold.
It's upsetting to me that it's now cold again, and it's practically midsummer. Anyway, come on, tell us what the party for Make Me a Supermodel was like. Just to remind listeners, this was the Channel 5 show that both myself and Joe were addicted to, about the attractive young ladies in a house behaving ludicrously and getting thrown out one by one by Rachel Hunter and a couple of other nobodies.
Peru and Tandy, they are not nobodies.
Sorry, did you meet Peru and Tandy?
I did not meet them, no. But I was sitting very near to them.
Anyway, it turned out this show on Channel 5, which is now finished, was produced by someone that used to produce our programme, the Adam and Joe Show. So we kind of canvassed on air for a ticket to go along to the final live kind of competition, and Joe went along.
I went along, yeah.
Where was it?
It was at a brewery near the Barbican, very, very chic venue, and I was sat, sorry, I don't know what happened there, weird bit of mucus, I was sat in the front row, basically, right next to the catwalk, where, at a proper fashion show, you know, big stars would sit.
Like Joe Cornish.
Joe Cornish, or,
wow.
Or Kate Moss, or
Pete
Doherty, or people like that, so I was sat there. To my left was Lisa Scott Lee. I'm not entirely
Elvis's
sure who
daughter.
She is. Is she from Steps?
She's from Elvis. No, yeah, she was from Steps.
Yeah. And, look, why are both of our production staff just reading the paper while we're talking?
They've heard it all before.
Lila, come on, look, even slightly interested in my
anecdotes.
Two things
at once. I am female.
Christmas Day.
Read and listen.
Look interested.
I heard you were sitting near the famous people near Kate Moss. Carry on.
To my left was Lisa Scott Lee. That doesn't wake you up. Nothing will. To my right was a very orange man. I don't know who he was, but he looked like Harry Hill if Harry Hill didn't dressed as a joke, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's really it. And the girls came out and they walked up and down, almost naked, right in front of me.
Brilliant.
And it was brilliant, but I was with my girlfriend who wasn't very comfortable about the whole occasion.
She could be a supermodel herself.
She could indeed, but I think she was questioning my motives.
Was she?
I think she thought, why does Joe want to come to this thing where 18-year-old girls parade up and down totally naked with snakes?
And what would be your explanation for that?
Because I fancy them.
But you're already going out with a very attractive girl.
I know, but you can't get enough attractive girls.
I suppose.
Isn't that a fact?
That's true.
And plus, I was very emotionally involved. And, you know, I spent a lot of time watching the families of the models, because they were all sat the other side of a catwalk from me.
Yeah.
All their relatives. And every time a VT package came on, every time they played some video in, everybody in that group of audience, everybody in the family, would turn around and watch it. Apart from Alice's dad, the girl who won, her dad. He looked a bit like a cross between Timothy Biggins and Timmy Mallett.
Who's Timothy Biggins? Christopher Biggins.
I'm sorry. And Timmy Mallett. And he just sat there looking quite depressed through the whole thing.
Well,
and then when his daughter won,
he got really depressed.
Really depressed.
Yeah,
and was applauding in a slightly lacklustre way. His hands were going, well done. And his face was going, this is the beginning of the end for my daughter.
See ya.
Oh, dear. I really felt for him. So I spent half of the time looking at his daughter naked and the other half of the time looking at him, empathising with how he felt about people like me looking at his daughter naked. So it was an extraordinary journey into the quandary that is very young models.
Wow.
Anyway, so
thanks for taking that journey for us.
There you go. But the best thing was, the next day, mm-hmm. I got home and
one of them was waiting for you.
No, sadly. Oh. A courier arrived with the most amazing goodie bag I've ever received.
From the model show?
From the model show. Enough beauty products. Hair curlers, hair straighteners, T-shirts, watches. Oh, to last me a lifetime.
A little sachet
amazing.
Of Charlie.
I smell so amazing now.
I thought you did.
Yeah, and I curled my hair, then straightened it.
Wow.
I'm wearing a tiny little pink T-shirt.
I love that thong
as
well.
I've got lip balm on.
That's great.
I am the sexiest man.
You definitely are.
In the world.
We've got Ditties in the Dock coming up very shortly. Here's a free play right now. This is The Fall. Okay, it's time for Ditties in the Dock here on the Adam and Joe programme on XFM. This is the part of the show where Joe and myself battle it out who gets to play the final song of our two-hour stint here on a Saturday afternoon. So, Joe, do you want to go first or shall I?
Well, I haven't really decided. I chose the subject this week to be space. Songs about space. Why did I choose that? Maybe because it was a kind of a Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy sort of week for me. I saw that midweek.
Oh, yeah.
Enjoyed it very much. And so I thought maybe a space theme would be good. But I can't decide what to choose.
Well, there's a lot of classic space songs.
Well, I've got Elton John with Rocket Man, but somehow I don't think XFM listeners are going to vote for that, are they?
Listen, you shouldn't play to the crowd. Just vote for what you love, man.
The disco theme from Star Wars by Miko. No one's going to vote for that, are they? It's
no.
Funny, though. That's funny. Carpenters with Calling. Occupants of Interplanetary Craft.
Can I just say...
No one will vote for that, will they?
You should have done this before you came into the studio.
Well, I'm trying to get some help.
There's
Bowie
no,
with Starman.
It's supposed
that's
to be
overplayed.
A vicious competition.
Oh, I don't know. I don't know. Okay, then. Elton John with Rocket Man. My choice is Elton John with Rocket Man, because I like it a lot. I really do, and I love singing along to it. And if you've got, you know, if you enjoy singing along to things, you'll enjoy singing along to it, too. Elton John is a big man with big man boobs. I saw him playing tennis the other day. He's an absurd, great roly-poly monster, isn't he? But I don't know what to say. It's a great song, and it's about space, so vote for it.
Wow.
It's not work, is it?
Well, you undersold it, because it is a classic
song. It's a classic song, so what else do I need to say?
I wouldn't mind being beaten by it, but... Or by him, in fact. But I've gone for something at the other end of the space spectrum. It's The Only Ones... with Another Girl, Another Planet, which is a classic kind of punk tune. And if you don't know it, this is an opportunity for you to introduce yourself to a wonderful world.
Is it very well known?
I would say it's pretty well known within the
world. It's on the best punk album in the world ever that I see you're holding in your
hand. Well, exactly. It's
so
also
it quite well known.
It's also a track from a classic album called SF
I'm
Sorrow.
Shafted.
No, it's not. It's not super well known.
Elton John is going to shaft me.
Listen. Either one of these songs is an absolute peach. So it's up to you, listeners, which one you go for. Either The Only Ones with Another Girl, Another Planet, or Elton John with Rocket Man.
And just to motivate you, three callers will win a copy of Apollo 13, the space film. You know, there you go, space film.
Space film.
Space, all about space.
We did a hilarious toy version of that once,
didn't we? We did, yeah, yeah.
Called Apollo 13, but we didn't quite spell it right. No, we spelt it weirdly with, like, maybe one L or two L's.
A-P-A-L-L-O, Apollo 13.
It was weird.
That's all right. It's funny.
Anyway.
It's early.
0871-222-1049 is the number to call. Just say, Elton or The Only Ones. Okay? Elton or The Only Ones. And we will find out which is the winner after we have some more music. Right now, who are we going to have? Oh, LCD Sound System with Daft Punk is playing at my house. Check it out. That is Razorlight with Somewhere Else, and before that, you heard LCD Sound System with Daft Punk is playing at my house.
Yes, it's Diddy's in the Dock, the part of the show where Adam and I fight it out to be the one who plays the last record. This week it is a space theme. Who are we playing against, Ad? Or what are the records?
Well, Joe, you've gone for Elton John with Rocket Man. My choice was The Only Ones with a punk classic entitled Another Girl, Another Planet.
We have callers on the line. I've lost their names. The callers on the line.
Hayley. Hayley, are you there?
I am here, hi.
How are you doing, Hayley?
I'm fine, thank you.
What are you up to today? You sound a little bit angry. Why are you angry?
No. I'm not. We're filming today. I'm student filmmakers. They're filming downstairs in my house.
Really?
That's a... around a bit. Yeah.
Why did you let them do that?
I don't know. I'm not quite sure.
That's famously a thing never to do if you're even vaguely proud of your house, is let a film crew in. Students
well,
as well.
Don't tell the landlord. Yeah.
What sort of a film are they making?
It's kind of comedy.
Have you read the script?
Yes, I'm
comedy porno.
And what film school are the students from?
Oh, hold on. Oh, yeah, sorry. I have to keep it. Sorry, University of Westminster.
Really? And they're telling you to keep it down because they're going for an important shot.
They are, yes.
They're going for the Monty.
Okay, what's
that's film jargon?
Who are you voting for, Hayley? Is it going to be the punk or the Ponce?
Only ones, please.
The Only Ones. It's one for The Only Ones. Okay, can you keep it down, please, Hayley?
Okay, and Hayley, you win a copy of Apollo 13 as well. Congratulations.
We're going for an MCU and we're using the Jilly Legs, so can you keep it down? Thanks very much for your call, Hayley, and hope you enjoy Apollo 13 by Ron Howard, the guy from Happy Days. Now we've got Neil on the line. How are you doing, Neil?
I'm fine, thanks. Yourself?
Yeah, very good. Thanks for asking. Bye. No, I'm joking. Sorry, Neil. Just talking rubbish. What are you going to vote for this afternoon? The Only Ones or Elton John?
The Only Ones.
Oh,
come on. I mean, it's a classic tune. There's no... But do you not even like Rocket Man?
I can't stand it.
What's your problem with Rocket Man? I mean, that was Joe's choice, but it is a good song. Is it too...
The Only One eclipses it by miles.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well, you win a copy of Apollo 13 there. Neil, thanks for calling. Thanks for listening.
Joe, man, you need some votes, otherwise you're out of the picture.
If I don't get a vote, this is it. It's over for me. It's funny, isn't it? Because we've only got three copies of Apollo 13. Maybe this next one. Oh, I don't know. Okay, Carly, hello?
Carly?
Ooh. What's happened?
Are you there, Carly?
Oh, hello, Carly.
I can hear her.
Line one. I'm here.
How you doing, Carly?
I'm good, thank you.
What are you up to?
I'm doing drama courses at the moment.
Really?
Yeah.
A lot of talented people listen to this show.
Are you teaching the course or taking it?
I'm taking it. And we're doing a performance on Tuesday, so I want to wish everyone loads of luck.
You're the drama queen.
What's your performance of?
It's called The Good Woman of Szechuan.
The Good One of Szechuan?
The Good Woman, yeah.
The Good... Oh.
Is it about a Chinese restaurant?
No, although that would have been fun.
Okay, so, Carly, what are you voting for, then?
The Only Ones.
Oh, well, fair enough.
I didn't even realise The Only Ones was such a popular choice. I thought maybe I'd get... I mean, they are fantastic. Do you know what? Have you got that album, SF Sorrow?
I'm afraid not.
It's a classic album, so I'm told. I don't even have it, and I've read about it all my life, and always loved Another Girl, Another Planet. I'm going out to buy it this afternoon, so I'm very excited.
Do you know what lesson I've learned from this today, Carly?
Uh-huh.
Is to just to choose rock, because it's a rock station, isn't it? So people who listen tend to like rock.
That's
where I've been going wrong.
Carly, thanks very much indeed for your call. And, well, that's a walkover for the only ones. But listen, that's a shame, I think, because...
No, no, no. You know, people can just listen to Heart FM if they want to hear Rocket Man, basically. That's the lesson I've learned as well.
Rocket Man transcends absolutely everything in music boundary-wise. It's one of the most amazing songs ever written.
Mm.
Anyway, that's just my opinion. This, however, is also very good, and I guess it is a bit more to do with what XFM's really all about. Anyway, hope you enjoy it. This is Adam and Joe saying farewell, have a good week.
Yeah, we'll see you next week. Thanks for listening.
Bye, love you! Good. That's the only ones with Another Girl, Another Planet. And just came back. We've got a little bit of housekeeping to do. First, I should apologise for being ignorant enough to get the Pretty Things and the Only Ones confused. It was, of course, the Pretty Things, whose album SF Sorrow is a classic, and that's the one I'm going to go buy this afternoon.
How very ignorant.
Sorry.
And don't forget to listen to Sean Keaveney on Monday from 10 a.m, as he'll be giving away copies of the Virgin Megastore's Album of the Week, which is Do Me Bad Things Is Yes! And for more chances to win, you can go to www.xfm.co.uk. This is Adam and Joe. We'll see you next week.
Bye! XFM.